please welcome Nando Parrado.
After all these years, how is it for you to watch these pictures?
They are part of my life, evidently. They don't move me now as much as they did some years ago, but it's a fantastic part of my life, especially those black and white when the helicopters come.
We have to start at the beginning of the story. You and your rugby team, you were on your way to Chile for a match. When did you realize you were in danger?
It only took me 5 or 6 seconds to realize that there was something wrong until the moment of impact. First, it was the elbow of my friend. He was sitting on the window. I was sitting on the aisle. And he hits me here. He says, Nando, look. And I look by the window. And that's 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds. And I saw these black and white mountains going by at the speed of the airplane, mixed with the clouds.
Was it like the plane crashed?
The plane hit the mountain with the belly, no, and it broke in half, lost the wings, and it's incredible how many things you can record in your mind in the last tenth of a second of your life, you know. And I remember this explosion of plastic and metal, this awful metallic sound, and the roof of the airplane opening over my head. Luckily for me, I was sitting on row 9 and the plane broke in half. Everybody who's sitting on row 10 and back died on impact. And then I was thrown into a black abyss. I died.
Into a coma for some days.
I was in a coma for 4 days.
How's Nando?
I don't think so.
Well, maybe it's just as well. His mother's dead.
And when you woke up, what was the situation like? I mean, what did you wake up to?
Somebody saw that I was moving and they said, hey, look, Nando is alive. So they put me against the side of the airplane. And I started to wake up very slowly and I was looking at eyes, you know, eyes and mouths speaking to me very gently and saying, Nando, Nando, we crashed, we crashed. And it took me about 3 or 4 or 5 hours to wake up. And then suddenly I saw everything destroyed inside the plane.
What?
Vanessa, look at Nando.
all right. I think he's all right. I think he's waking up.
Nando?
Nando. See, I told you.
Don't be grinding your teeth like that. You'll ruin your smile. Nando. Focus on me. Come on, focus on me. Focus on me.
And instantly I say, but I was not alone here.
My mother?
She's dead.
And they were very blunt to me. They say, Nando, your mother is dead. You know, Guido is dead. Alexis is dead. Panchito is dead. And Susie is wounded. My sister was
your
wounded.
Your sister, yes.
She was injured.
Where is she?
I'm gonna get a rest for her. She's been unconscious.
Where is she? Where is she?
Susanna! Susanna!
Nando!
Susanna?
I just focused on my sister. I crawled to where she was, and I took care of her.
And you were badly hurt yourself.
Yeah, I was completely covered in blood, and my head was the size of a basketball. I had 4 fractures in my head, and some cuts in my legs. But I focused on her until she died in my arms.
Susanna's dead. Tonight, tomorrow, I'll take her out.
This story is also famous for what then happened when you didn't have any food. I mean, you had to take extreme measures.
Yes.
When did you decide to do that?
It's, I think our history, our story is very interesting from that point of view. For us, it was only the only thing we could do.
Now, if the search has been called off, then we're on our own to save our lives, and we've got to eat.
Eat what?
After 10 days, we heard on a small transistor radio that the search had been abandoned. We were left at 5,000 meters, no clothes, no food, no water, no rescue. What do you do? You change. You're another person. You turn yourself into a survival machine.
All right. Yeah.
And 2.5 weeks after the plane crashed, there was a huge avalanche. Because it snows, snows gets on top of the mountains, then it falls by gravity. And we were right under the avalanche, and it buried 27 of us, and it killed 8. Thank you.
were 16 left.
Yeah, then three, four more died. And then I had to get out of there. I walked out with a friend. I say walked out. We trekked 70 kilometers, 10 days and a half. We crossed the whole Andes Mountains on foot.
With street shoes?
With street shoes.
And I mean, experts say that this is almost humanly impossible to cross the Andes Mountains like that.
Yeah.
Why do you think you made it?
Because I wanted to see my father. I knew that he was back at home, having lost his wife, his daughter, his son. And we were a normal family, but I knew he couldn't sleep, he couldn't work, he couldn't think. And I was alive. And the love for my father gave me the strength to go over those mountains.
How did that happen? I mean, you went over the mountains, could you then see like a green valley or?
I thought I would see the green valleys of Chile on the other side, and the only thing I saw when I stood up there at 6,000 meters were mountains, 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 and nothing but mountains.
You and your friend?
Yeah, me and Robert.
Nothing but mountains. We've had it. We've completely had it. No, we haven't. In two of these mountains somewhere, there's a green valley. You see these mountains over here? There's no snow on them.
Those mountains must be 50 miles away. You think I can walk 50 miles?
If we have to, we will.
I can't.
Yes, you can.
I can't. I'm not as strong as you.
You know what it is that we've lived this long the way we have? 70 days that we climb this mountain. You know what it is? It's impossible. It's impossible, and we did it.
I know.
I'm proud to be a man on a day like this.
And over there, I took the biggest decision of my life. I saw what I had in front, and in 30 seconds, I told Roberto, look, we are dead, Roberto. There's no way we'll get out of here. But I'll start walking, because I'll be closer to my father each step that I'll give. And he looked at me and he said, okay, we have done so many things together. Let's die together. And it's not a book, it's not a movie. It's two friends at 6,000 meters in 30 seconds deciding to die. And what other decision can be compared to that one in life? Unless you commit suicide, who knows when he's going to die? We knew we were going to die together. You know, so that's, for me, the utmost and most profound form of friendship I've ever seen. He looked at me and said, let's die together.
You see where the sun's going to set? That way's west. Into the west of the green valleys of Chile.
We're gonna die, you know.
Maybe. But if we die, we're gonna die walking.
And luckily we didn't die.